Between private servers and official releases, World of Warcraft Vanilla has to be one of the most remixed or relaunched games of all time, whether it be the world, the class balance, or lack thereof, raids or quests. This game has some sort of charm that seems to be hard to shake. With all of these different versions floating about, it's gotten confusing enough to warrant a comprehensive historical archival. So without further delay, this is the history of Vanilla World of Warcraft. Our story begins in 1999, flashback to a time when Blizzard Entertainment was synonymous not with controversy, but with quality, a reputation that was built off the back of three franchises, StarCraft, Diablo, and Warcraft. Warcraft at this point existed only as a real-time strategy series where players commanded troops around a battlefield and completing story-based objectives in its PvE mode and against each other in its PvP modes. It was a cool series, and it earned a sizable fanbase who were waiting for the third installment. But where they expected an announcement of Warcraft 3, what they got was the World of Warcraft. It wasn't an RTS, but rather an MMO, which was at the time a comparatively niche genre that was rife with experimentation and resulting failure. Actually, in its very first form, World of Warcraft was made within the Warcraft 3 engine, perhaps as an experiment, but it wouldn't be long until it transitioned to the more appropriate MMO style. So, instead of controlling armies, players would control just one character, their own. One that they made and customized and even named with one goal: lose yourself in an online virtual world. Its existence was announced in the Computer Gaming World magazine in 2001, where the developers pitched a much more friendly and casual design philosophy to contrast what was then a very unforgiving and hardcore genre. Development continued, and internal alpha testing began, and many today are surprised to learn that the private server community existed during a time before Cataclysm, and even more surprised to learn that the birth of private servers started even before the game was released in 2003 during its alpha, which can be traced all the way back by a person known as Skull, who through some social engineering obtained the alpha client either from an external alpha tester or a Blizzard employee themselves. The following message was posted around gaming forums from across the web. Open source proponents, crackers, and anarchists alike rejoice as an alpha version of World of Warcraft has allegedly been secured and is now supposedly making its way around WoW circles. This news comes from Skull's hack site, who says Warforge, infamous for their work with Battle.net emulation for Warcraft 3 and TFT betas, is already working on server software for the WoW leak. Availability for those outside of cracking groups is limited at best, and the situation has just now grown past rumor, but details and screenshots can be found here and here if you wish to judge for yourself. Blizzard was pissed, and they posted the following in retaliation. As many of you know, we are currently conducting an internal alpha test for World of Warcraft. Our goal for this alpha test is to provide the best possible experience for players when the beta launches in early 2004, and in order to accelerate the testing process, we recently allowed a small group of external testers to play the game. During this process, a collection of files were leaked to the internet. While these files contain alpha content from the game, they're not fully playable, and therefore they do not convey the experience that WoW will provide when it's released. We're currently investigating this matter, and we will take serious action against those involved. As always, we appreciate the interest and enthusiasm that players around the world have for WoW, and we look forward to delivering a massively multiplayer game unlike any you have ever experienced. Until then, we ask that you refrain from sharing any content that doesn't come directly from Blizzard Entertainment. So, once it was released, Pandora's box was opened, and it marked the birth of the private server community, which would have a substantial impact on the development of World of Warcraft moving forward. A person named Lax began reverse engineering WoW with nothing more than a couple of packet logs, and he and another person named Cold Ice created what was known as the Stormwind Sandbox, which set the stage for all future emulation projects from this point forward.
There is also no indication that anything can slow the explosive growth of the intoxicating game called World of Warcraft.
Regardless of all of this, November came, and along with it, one of the most iconic games of all time, quickly turning the MMORPG genre from niche to mainstream. Anyone who had a gaming PC played it, and those who didn't have one soon bought one. Your friends, family, teachers, celebrities. It coincided with the rise of social media, and millions soon joined the addiction sweeping across the world. Behind the scenes, the private server community was still developing, as they had started working on spells and pathfinding, but while World of Warcraft was reaching millions of paid subscribers, these private servers would only reach hundreds of free players, which was still unprecedented. The first emulator that was considered to be serious was called Stormcraft, which was soon followed by hundreds of others, such as Rift, Future WoW, Team Python, Chaos, Vibe, WoW Demon, to name just a few. Regardless, their lifespan was always short. Either they would fail to attract enough players to make it worth continuing, or if they were to actually become popular, they would subsequently be shut down by Blizzard. Infighting and egotism would also hinder their progress. An emulator called WoW Emu rose from the ashes of a recent shutdown of WoW Demon, and as they worked privately on reverse engineering the game, a group called BlizzHackers would crack their code and release it publicly, eventually leading to WoW Emu stopping entirely out of protest.
Screw you guys! I'm going home!
While this was all going on, vanilla World of Warcraft was thriving, but yet still moving forward, and on October 28th of 2005, after much anticipation, the first expansion for WoW, The Burning Crusade, was announced, promising new content such as zones, dungeons, raids, arena, new races, and much more. The day of release eventually came on January 16th, 2007, and it was met with great success and acclaim, and the expansion today is looked back to very fondly, but regardless, with it came an end to something special, as the base game, World of Warcraft, was now known as Vanilla World of Warcraft. The game continued to evolve with the Wrath of the Lich King expansion on November 13th, 2008. It was another extremely popular addition to the game that added a lot of content and features, but as time went on, people had begun to notice that it had very slowly but surely started to become more and more distant from the original base game that they had originally been captivated by. The balance became better, the classes more refined, the quests more complex, it started to become more goal-oriented, every action had started to reward some sort of tangible reward such as experience or an item or an achievement, and the story shifted away from the world and towards major lore characters, complete with quite extravagant cutscenes and cinematics at the time. The game had evolved on so many levels, yet still, what it was losing was charm. With each update, there were fewer and fewer things that existed just for the sake of existing. As classes became more balanced, they also became more homogenized and less interesting. Old school RPG elements were deemed to be outdated or too complex and were removed entirely. And people had started to become nostalgic of the old zones and dungeons and raids and composition of the game that they once explored.
Very, very geeked up to debut an expansion set that I'm confident will be nothing less than earth-shattering. An expansion set that will very literally change the face of the world of Azeroth as you know it. Ladies and gentlemen,
August 21st, 2009, in BlizzCon, Blizzard would announce the next expansion to WoW, The Cataclysm. After much anticipation, the leader of the Black Dragonflight, Deathwing, was back, and as he would reshape the world, Blizzard would reshape their game. Old zones would be renovated, classes would be homogenized even further, as would loot, even more RPG elements were removed, and the game had become more goal-oriented than it ever was. From top to bottom, Azeroth, as players knew it, was getting a complete makeover. It was at this point, in all of its history, that they had reached their peak in subscribers, 12 million, but as it would soon turn out, shortly after, for the first time since its release in 2004, World of Warcraft had started losing subscribers, and it wasn't due to another big, successful MMO entering the scene. Rather, it seemed that people had started to simply lose interest. This would prove to be a pivotal moment, not just for Blizzard, but for private server communities as well, because it was at this point is where old Azeroth was lost forever, and many had started to yearn to relive it from the only place that still offered it. Private servers, which had started to gain newfound popularity. A few servers had emerged as frontrunners, such as Phoenix or Vanilla Gaming, due to their lack of popularity previous to this point, and also previously mentioned infighting. The game was still a shadow of its former self. The scripting and mob pathing and the spells were all over the place, highly inaccurate. Many of the events or quests simply didn't work. Cheating was rampant, as was corruption, where GMs would generate items for players in exchange for real-life money, or ban people they simply didn't like. But yet still, it offered something that Blizzard wasn't at the time. Vanilla World of Warcraft. And as retail would continue in a direction further away from the 2004 hit, these private servers would only grow and grow, with each new release eclipsing the last in population. It was pretty clear. Despite the fact that these private servers weren't effectively advertised en masse, and despite the major issues with glitches, bugs, and corruption, people were still finding them and playing them. There's just something about Vanilla WoW that was just magnetic and timeless. Yet still, there were those who were unhappy with the quality of these private servers, and instead campaigned Blizzard, frequently posting on the forums detailing the popularity of these private server communities, and arguing that there is a clear demand for an official recreation. This would create something of a faction war within its own community, vanilla versus current, a battle that still rages on today because people like to treat video games like girlfriends. It was essentially fans who had become jaded and they disliked the more modernized version of the game versus those who dismissed these gripes as nostalgic and misguided. As for Blizzard, they would disregard these pleas and remain quite firm, either that it was impossible to do as they didn't have the code anymore, or the players are confused and they don't know what they're asking for, something that would be parroted by the current faction as they would create a copy-paste called the Wall of No, containing paragraphs upon paragraphs of why vanilla servers would never happen, why that's a good thing. The whole thing got insanely petty and hilarious, as internet nerd fights often tend to be. The community was, and still is, incredibly split, and any discussion surrounding vanilla servers would quickly devolve into flame wars and toxicity.
Have you ever thought about adding servers for previous expansions as they were then?
No.
In 2013, however, things would reach a climax of sorts. During a Q&A panel for an upcoming expansion, The Warlords of Draenor, a fan asked the developers on the possibility of vanilla servers.
And by the way, you don't want to do that either. You think you do, but you don't. Remember when you had to like spam cities and say, need a tank, need a tank, need a tank during the Burning Crusade days? You don't remember that because now you just push a button that says go to the dungeon. You don't want to do that.
It was clear. The developers themselves had become annoyed and perhaps insulted by the players' wishes to play what they dismissed as archaic and inferior. Come on, why don't you want to play this awesome expansion? It's going to be so good. But The answer was something that the vanilla player base had become quite accustomed to. It was dismissive and condescending, but more importantly, it would serve as a rallying cry of sorts and some point towards this moment as the most pivotal for what would soon become unseen levels of popularity within the private server community. A server called Nostalrius would launch on February 28th, 2015, and would set new records of activity. Despite major issues such as rollbacks, raids resetting after crashing, and other impactful glitches, people still played, reaching an astonishing 800,000 registered accounts. It was by and large the most popular private server for vanilla since their inception in 2003. Unfortunately though, for Nostalrius, their success ended up being their downfall as they had become popular enough to attract the attention of Blizzard, and under threat of lawsuit, they were forced to shut down, which, as you would imagine, would only fuel the flames. The player base was irate because the situation was as follows. They wanted vanilla, Blizzard refused to produce it, and are now actively shutting down people who are providing it. It's understandable to be emotional in such a circumstance, but to be fair, it's a pretty short-sighted way of looking at things, as Blizzard doesn't even have a choice. They're compelled under law to protect their IP. They're a publicly traded company. If they were to ignore blatant copyright infringement, they risk lawsuits from their shareholders, as Blizzard is not profiting from people playing a version of their game. Still, understandably, the community was frustrated as they wanted vanilla. There was a clear demand for it, but not only was Blizzard refusing to provide it, they were shutting down ways to play it, leaving the only option a version of the game that many had become very jaded with. Blizzard would respond to this controversy with a suggestion of what they called Pristine Realms, which would be the rule sets of the current game, which was Legion at the time, but turning off all of the level acceleration bonuses such as heirlooms, level boosts, disabling the WoW token, and so on, as it felt like these services damage the original design philosophy of the game. Hold on to this thought, because it becomes very important later on. This was not received well, however, as the old world would still be missing, the class balance would be current, as well as a plethora of other retail design philosophies that would negatively impact vanilla. It was seen as a half measure. But there was a silver lining in this whole debacle, as after the server was shut down, Blizzard had invited some of the Nostalrius staff to their headquarters in California for a meeting. No one outside of who was invited knew what was said in this meeting for months. Some speculated legal proceedings, but some of the more hopeful anticipated a big announcement in the near future.
I want to take a minute. And I want to talk about ice cream. Ice cream is great. Ice cream is one of my favorite desserts. Personally, I love chocolate, and I love cookies and cream. Cookies and cream is actually my all-time favorite dessert. But I understand that for some of you, your favorite flavor is vanilla.
On November 4th, 2017, 13 years after its initial release, at that year's BlizzCon, Jalen Brack, the same developer who, in 2013, dismissed the fan for asking for vanilla servers, announced the existence of World of Warcraft Classic. After finding the backup of a backup from an ex-employee, they had found some critical data that was stopping them from making Classic, and the team had begun to work on it around the same time that Nostalrius was shut down. The release would work as follows. It's vanilla World of Warcraft with the old world, quests, class balance as it was in the final vanilla patch, which was 1.12, with progressive content releases to roughly mirror the original cadence of updates, such as Battlegrounds being added in later, the Diremal dungeon, and raid releases for the most major, and item and recipe changes for the more minor. They would advertise all of the charm of vanilla, but perhaps even more importantly, also the lack of features that would conflict with it, such as dungeon finders, raid finders, and also microtransactions. The fan base erupted. After years of campaigning, Official Classic was going to be a thing. The beta would kick off next year, followed by a playable demo that limited players to Westfall and the Barrens, and on August 27th, 2019, it would release officially to overwhelming success. Like, literally, the servers overflowed with players. Queues would balloon up to several hours, or even days in some instances. They took the amount of servers that they had on launch, and then doubled them, scrambling to keep up with the unforeseen interest in a game that was at that point 15 years old. A report came soon after that Classic's launch had tripled their subscription revenue. No one knew the exact numbers at the time, because at that point Blizzard were hiding subscriptions after they had begun to tumble in the Warlords of Draenor expansion. But many years later, in a GDC panel, developers shared some internal subscriber charts, and it was revealed that vanilla not only gave World of Warcraft its biggest surge in subscribers since its initial decline that started in Cataclysm, but it also retained those players. Those who screamed rose-colored goggles and reposted the Wall of No had egg on their face. It was true. There seemed to be something about the design of a 15-year-old video game that players found more appealing. Although the re-release didn't fully retain the huge boon from launch, which is standard for MMOs, it did retain a healthy player base all the way to its end in the Naxxramas phase. On February 19th, 2021, as expected at this point due to Classic Vanilla's success, the Burning Crusade Classic was announced, where the players have the option of carrying their characters over to the Outland, or for a fee, copying them to permanent Classic Era realms that would persist on the final Naxxramas phase, or both. But controversially, it was announced that the Burning Crusade portion was to be released with microtransactions.
We are going to offer a level 58 boost for purchase, but it does come with some restrictions. So it's going to be one per account. It's not going to be usable on Blood Elf or Draenei.
Now realizing the popularity of Classic, Blizzard had set to monetize it much like they did with the current version of the game, despite contradicting themselves by stating several times that microtransactions clash with the identity of Classic. The monotonous Adonis, a man who goes by the name Mad Season Show, made a one-hour video detailing these events and predicted that the World of Warcraft token was sure to follow. In response, people cried slippery slope fallacy, the WoW token releases, and all of these people disappear into the bush because he told them so, by the way. But the Burning Crusade releases nonetheless, and as it turns out from this chart, unfortunately to a whimper compared to the success of Vanilla. Considering how favorably players looked at the Burning Crusade as an expansion, some believe this betrayal to be the reason for the lukewarm response, and that buying character progression in a genre of game centered around character progression is actually a bad thing. Who'da thunk it? But nonetheless, it hobbled along, and as it turned out, the story of Vanilla was far from over, as the Season of Mastery was announced to be released on November 16th of the same year. This would be a relaunch of Vanilla World of Warcraft, but this time with some changes. Although the 2019 re-release attempted to emulate the original 2004 release pretty closely, since the makeup of the player base and the environment surrounding the game had changed quite drastically at this point, the experience was predictably different. Particularly, the difficulty of the raiding was quite easy, so this would be increased with more deadly bosses and added mechanics. It would also alter the game in other various ways, such as speeding up how quickly players leveled by increasing quest experience. It would be received with enthusiasm at first, but it would soon see a significant drop-off after the players had begun to clear Molten Core. The reasons for this are subject to debate. Some speculate that it was too early off of the end of the vanilla re-release. Others say that shortening the leveling sped players closer to the finish line, leaving them with little reason to play. And some say that the trivial raiding scene had become part of vanilla's identity, and that the increased difficulty had harmed the game. No one can really agree, but it wasn't a very popular version of the game. On April 19th, 2022, back to the original 2019 line of Classic, Wrath of the Lich King was announced. Players would once more storm the continent of Northrend in an effort to slay Arthas Menethil as the Lich King, complete with the amenities that the expansion brought in its original release in 2008, such as the Death Knight class, achievements, Dungeon Finder, multiple raid difficulties, and much more. It would release officially on September 26th, followed by the WoW token, told you so by the way, and similarly to the Burning Crusade, to a much lower response compared to the 2019 re-release. Back over in vanilla, there was some activity going on with hardcore mode, and it was completely community driven. Those who were disillusioned with the expansion re-releases had congregated and started a self-imposed community challenge. The rules were simple, but harsh. Death is permanent. If you died, you deleted your character. An add-on was created to track and enforce these restrictions, and it would become quite popular. Popular enough, in fact, that Blizzard would announce official hardcore servers where permanent death is built into the game. These servers launched on August 24th, 2023, to great excitement and activity at first, but they would substantially lose momentum when the newest season of Vanilla, the Season of Discovery, was announced, along with the next expansion, Cataclysm Classic. The sequel to the Season of Mastery, this version would change the game in more radical ways. Some would even describe it as Classic Plus, which is a version of Vanilla that vaguely changes the game in various ways, such as new raids, updated balance, and so on. There's no one true definition as to exactly what it is, but changes include the rune system, where players hunt down spell runes and apply them to their gear, granting new abilities and passives. Some would be returning from other expansions, and others were completely new, but regardless, they would drastically alter the class balance of Vanilla. New crafting recipes were added to balance the profession system, and much like the 2019 release, it would release in phases to drip feed the players the content, with even levels being limited on a phase-by-phase basis. Low-level dungeons were rebalanced into 10-man and 20-man raids as a form of endgame for each of these phases, and as of this video, it stands at phase 3, which is level 50. Although it started off quite popular, it's currently stagnant, as it's been a couple of months since the last phase release, with no substantial information shared on when the next is out, and also because people are spending their time in Cataclysm Classic, which would release during this third phase on May 20th, 2024. Ironically enough, the expansion that most drastically changed the game from vanilla has seen a re-release in the original 2019 line of Classic, and it follows the same form of the 2010 release, the only exception being more microtransactions. During all of this, the private server community would once more begin picking up steam, primarily in the form of Classic Plus, primarily two servers, which are Turtle WoW and Ascension, which offer their own unique forms of Classic Plus, including class changes, dungeons, quests, to name just a few. And that's where we stand today, as of June of 2024. The original 2019 line is now on Cataclysm Classic, which is the freshest launch by Blizzard. The Season of Discovery is the newest form of Vanilla. The Era servers are still running, and every now and then, the community will band together to create these self-imposed fresh runs in Vanilla on these Era servers. Currently, that's happening on Deviant Delight. And outside of that, the private server community is once more gaining momentum behind the scenes, as every few months there'll be a fresh vanilla launch, either from established communities or new ones entirely. Despite your opinions on all of this, whether you personally enjoy vanilla or classic or not, the fact that this game has been re-released or remixed like 10,000 times should speak for itself. There just seems to be something about the classic MMO design that still appeals to people. Whether that be the world, the balance, the social structures, charm, whatever it is, it clearly provides something that modern MMOs failed to provide, or else so many different versions just wouldn't exist. But regardless of all of that, I just thought that this video was worth making. There's so many different versions out there, it can get kind of confusing, and the history is so rich that it would be a shame to lose it all to the ether. So, for what it's worth, this is the history of classic World of Warcraft. Like the video if you liked it, because I'll see you in the next one. Peace.
Farewell for now, mortals. We hope you enjoyed today's video. See you again soon.